loves to show the world. And this is, I don't judge, but it is a very dangerous thing to do. And it's very dangerous for two very specific reasons. The first thing being, we all know from real life, lies and the persona is a lie are extremely hard to keep up. There's so many details that you have to think of, there's so many implications. It doesn't really feel like you, so you can't always embody the persona. It's just something that requires tremendous effort to keep up. And the second one being, it's dangerous because it often slips into caricature versions of the person, into a very laughable comic version. I brought today three examples of a caricature persona which applies, I think, to maybe all of us at some point during the day or during our lives, but also especially to a lot of brands. And the first one, I think we know this really well, is the politician. Again, if there are any politicians here, I assume not, but it's this feeling of you don't really know who you're talking to. Like they say one thing in 1 minute, or they say another thing, and they deceive you, they try to be friends with everyone, but they're not really with anyone, and honesty is very much down the chart. So, again, talking about an ideal company of politicians. So this is a caricature version. The second one is the loudmouths. People who constantly scream at you. They scream at you, they want your attention. And they feel like they deserve every last drop of your attention. Though they don't, right? And you've got other shit to do, and you have other people to talk to. And anyways, they still scream at you. And they really don't care actually what you want or who you are or how they deserve it in a real way. And the third one, this is a little bit painful on the inside when you experience it. It's, I hope you've all seen the film Mean Girls, but it's a great film, quick recommendation. Recommend it to all of you. The parents will try to be cool. They try to hang with the cool kids, they try to use slang words, though they're not real slang words and no one uses it. And they try to go on social media, though they don't really know what the fuck to post. And so, it's not a problem, it's just don't do things that you can't embody, right? I mean, the parents sometimes are a wonderful example, and also it's a good reminder for all of you, you might eventually become parents, so think of this side and think about how you know the parent is just trying. And so, okay, you see, authenticity is not that easy. And so what I want to share today is not the only way to authenticity. It's too much, too complex for the theme, and we got our individual views today, so we see there are some contradictions. But I want to share with you the three most basic and easy to understand and also pragmatical principles that I use in my daily work to pursue authenticity in the brands I want. And the first one, and I also hope you've all seen this movie, is find your groove. And so this is really important, right? And the emphasis is really on your. Because when we're building a brand, a lot of times we think about the market and the trends and the competition and I don't know, what do the customers want, right? But like it's so easy to forget this is your company. You are building this with your employees. You're trying to do something for the world. You're trying to share something, right? So think about that first. Like, you know, it's like in real life. Think about yourself first. What can you share for the world? And then try to think what the world wants for you. And why do I call it a groove? I mean, for me, it has to. The main thing is it has to feel right. Okay, it has to sit well with you. It has to embody why you're there, how you're going to do it, what you're going to do it. Also. This is a little rhyme for you right there, so and your groove should make you move, right? And I mean that in a metaphorical sense as well, right? It should move you, right? You should feel it move you, like, oh right, this is what we're going with. This is inspiring, this is filling me with energy. And if it makes you move and the people around you move, they make more people move. They will be able to feel it and they will be, alright, now I catch that groove. My dance is very bad, but you can dance, right? You can sort of try to dance your groove, and that's the next point. You have to define your groove, and this is usually our work, and a lot of times it's done into text. So you write a tagline, or come up with a name, or a fancy advertising campaign, whatever. But a groove, you can find, you can expressing any sort of way. Yeah? It can be dancing, it can be heck, write a piece of poetry if you have to. If the God is what you want to do with your company, with the world, then do it. Do a sculpture, I don't care, but define your group. And here's a really good tip to go by. Your group, or the definition of it, it can be complex. It can be a brand strategy with 50 pages, but never complicated. What I mean by complicated is exactly this. It's, I don't even know what it is. It's, you have all these different like parts of it, and then you're looking at all sides, and looking inside and outside, and how can you make a groove out of this? How can you move people with this? How? It's not possible. I mean, anyways, if you can, then show me and we can talk about it again. But it's not possible. And the second thing is, you know, don't try too hard, right? if you just can't put your groove into words, I mean, look at Deutsche Bahn. They've been changing their slogan for 20 times or something. And the problem is not that it changed a lot, the problem is it all means nothing. It just, like, 99 read bit of a let's talk about it. It's like, what, are you my bank or my therapist? I don't know, I just, you know, I give you my money, I don't want to talk. It's really weird, actually. And so this is a perfect example of someone who might not be brave enough to show what might be their real group, which might just be, you like money. And that would be, you know, completely okay. I don't mind someone saying you just like money and like paying money. By the way, Deutsche Bank, if anyone's here, I don't know your company, no offense, I'm just making sense. But anyways, just illustrating the point here. You like money, it's okay. It might come from the heart. There will be people who would understand that.
Second one.
Try what you enjoy to do, basically. And take your brand and try to make it as human as possible. And why? There's a very simple answer. We know human. There's no concept, no other concept in this world that we know better than human. We've grown up with them, we've been looking at their behavior, we know our family, our friends, we know how they, what their visions are, what their motivations are, we have an intuitive view, we connect with them. So try to think of your brand as a real human. But if you're not Tom Cruise, don't try to be Tom Cruise, right? Like, if your brand is not a Tom Cruise brand, if that's not who you are, then don't try to be it. It's as simple as that. And I get this, and probably you get this as well a lot, in our presentations with clients, and we say, yeah, we all like the strategy, it's very nice, but can we be a little bit more like Coca-Cola? I'm like, no, you can certainly not, because you're not Coca-Cola. And if we give you a Tom Cruise haircut and his clothes, you still won't have his charisma or acting chops or his house, or I don't know, it will not be you, so it doesn't make sense to do that. Why would you? It's just changing your business. By the way, I'm not promoting Tom Cruise, it's just the perfect person I love. And also, don't try to be that, okay? We're not trying to do that as well. But here's actually much more practical way to go about it. And it is what we do in real life as well, when we're trying to get to know someone, right? What do you do if you realize you want to get to know them? Ask them on a date, I mean, it's very traditional, but anyways. You ask them on a date, you sit down and you ask questions. That's it. You start with maybe really simple questions like, what do you do? How long do you do it? Who do you work with? What music do you listen to? What do you like to do in the morning? And then you move into a more, you know, deeper, more meaningful sort of question. So maybe, what do you value in life? What do you plan for the next 10 years? What do you regret? How do you want others to treat you? And how do you like to treat others? What are the values that you really want in your life? So I think you should date your brand, okay? Just imagine your brand sitting across from you, you ask all these questions, and you get genuine information about what you are. And then, on the second step, you might go and try to imagine what it would be like to sit down with other brands, just as an exercise, right? Sit down with these budget brands. And what, you know, what would you talk about? What would they embody? What would they come up with? Would they just be talking about the markets, the budget sales? What would they actually be a philosophy? Try to imagine, try to think what stands behind for Google. Would they just flood you with information? Or would they actually listen and write down and observe everything and put it in the server about everything you do? And what about Nike? Would they just jump around and try to, you know, run away? Or would they enforce your goals, tell you to just do it? Or with Chanel, would it be a fancy tea time? Or I don't know, would it just be YouTube getting problems? So what's behind it? I'm trying to imagine the medicine for people. And I was making sure. The third one is show your buttons. Right? Some people like elephants, some people like donkeys, and it's the same for brands. We have our beliefs, and I'm not talking about opinions here for a reason, because opinions are informed by irrational thoughts and facts and data and all that. There's a time and place for that, but not for your brand. Your brand is about core belief, and from what core belief we show your biases. I know it's a little bit of a negative word, but ultimately it comes down to show what you believe and what you stand for. And yeah, it's okay to offend people sometimes. Don't go around and cursing people, you're a butthole, you're an asshole, I don't know. Don't do that. I mean, really, because I might get into trouble. But it's okay to offend people. You have your unique worldview, and other people might not share it, and then they might get offended. But it's okay. I mean, we have our beliefs and we share that. That's just what human life is about. Yeah. So when you think about how the brand should act, go with this. The talk should be the talk and the walk, actually. It should be yes, yes, no, no. It should be either yes or no. It should be clear. You know what you stand for, you know what you want to do. So say it, show it, right? And a very good example is this, actually. The campaign from Dollar Shave Club, which you might know. They sell shaving gear at a really reasonable price. And they make this campaign about who they're not a good gift for, right? Who are not the kinds. And this is nice because they're sharing like who they don't need as customers. You know, they're not saying everyone should shave, everyone has to have a clean face. They're saying if you like shaving and you want to have a better experience, a more efficient, cheaper, smart experience, you're the brand. And if you don't want to shave, fine, then don't buy our products. That's okay, it's our belief, that's your belief, fine. I mean, that example on the other hand is Villa, and you can all experience this after or in the game. And on the left hand side, you have paper bags which say paper instead of plastic. And on the right hand side, you have all these pastries wrapped up. There's a mountain of plastic. And like, walk the walk, right? It should be yes or no. So what is it? Are you environmentally conscious or not? It's okay if you're not, but like, then don't pretend. Then don't just put a couple of paper bags and everyone's like, oh, they're so environmentally conscious. And when you actually, again, Villa, sorry, it's just obvious and it's redundant. And same with the Facebook story feature. I mean, it's almost like you have nothing better to do. You're just copying the feature, the core feature of your main competitor, Snapchat. And I'm sorry, but this is, you have the world's smartest people and this is what you come up with. I'm really not very impressed. And yeah, lastly, and this is more of a embarrassing parents kind of thing. If there's a concept out there, a trend, and you don't understand it, then don't use it. Like, or learn about it. But like, just don't just go and throw hashtags around and go storytelling and do all these things that people do now. Like, don't do it. There's no shame in not doing it. But like, if it's not authentic, if it just comes from within, just don't. Yes, yes, no. And the same goes for buzzwords. They're empty shells. Just stay away from them. They make you look undecided and politician-y. So just find your own language and speak. And as last words here, sometimes it's really, really, really good to know when you don't have to speak, right? So if it's a sensitive holiday, and it's about remembrance, about not promoting your brand, you should just realize when you don't have to speak, because sometimes silence is indeed good.
When you look at it a little deeply, a little more deeply, you actually find it's quite a complex, confusing issue. So I'm trying to bring a little bit of clarity into the topic. A little bit around the question, how authentic is authenticity? So a few thoughts about that. Now, often the word authentic is connected with food. Yeah? We think about, oh, I'd love to go to an authentic Italian tonight, or have a nice authentic Indian meal. So it's really like what we can get in here. But obviously, not in Italy, it's not really authentic. But we want authentic, millennials want authentic. But do we really want authentic? We don't want authentic all the time, that's the interesting thing. If you look at Disney World, I mean, come on, people in costumes are not real. We know they're not real. But still we like it and we appreciate that brand. Wonder Bra, also made really, I'm sorry to say. Also in this case, the truth comes out in the end. We know it's a little bit of cheating, but we don't like. So it's not exactly authentic, but it makes us feel good as well. And even in when you meet a new partner or a potential partner, you know, you put your best side forward, don't you? You try and make yourself a little bit funnier, maybe a little bit more entertaining. You put your best pillow fighting persona to the fore to impress somebody, but it's also not quite real on the other person we find out later down the line. But it's like we do, and we kind of need that, and we like it in many cases. In many cases, it's fine. Sometimes we don't need it, sometimes we want authenticity. This picture, this is a person, obviously, who changed how he thought altogether about authenticity. The complete inauthenticity was the total point here, by saying it doesn't matter what other people think of you, if they think you're authentic or not. The main thing is that you think you're authentic. Then you can be anything you want. It's authentic for you. That's all that matters. And we love that, didn't we? Some people loved it. Some people hated it. The world leader said it will be the end of Europe because of that. So you see, authenticity is a very, very subjective issue. What I find authentic, probably I'm British, so it's probably not the same thing that you find authentic. I love British food, you probably say that. It's very a subjective issue. And we're ambivalent about it. If you think about this gentleman, who I grew up with, okay, it's not my dad, but my childhood is associated with this person, and yet it's me. It's around to play. But it's make-believe that we want to have, make-believe that does us good, make-believe that makes our kids happy for Christmas Day, and that's reason enough for it to be okay. When we don't like authenticity, is when we're told one thing, but the truth is another. We're told to believe one thing, the truth is another. What I mean by that, I don't mean Disney, because Disney, we know, it's not real. Father Christmas, okay, when you're little, at some point, you find out. Here's an example of what I mean. Innocent, and again, this is subjective, it's all subjective. Innocent, often we have workshops with clients, one of the first questions is, what's your favourite brand? And there's always somebody who says, Innocent, oh, you're lovely, so authentic, and really good labels and stuff, it's all natural fruit, and such a brilliant idea, and the hats, so funny. And I say, well, you do know it's owned by Coca-Cola, don't you? That's an information that often just wipes the smile off people's face. The product is exactly the same, but it's changed. Just that piece of information. You're sometimes, in fact, often in the case of when somebody's favourite brand, immediately make it their least favourite brand. They lose trust because they've been taught to believe in innocence and all the wonderful things this brand stands for, and they find out that the company is sold out, not to a company with similar values, but to Coca-Cola. It's not about the money, it's about this clash of what we perceive Coca-Cola to stand for. That's where authenticity starts for you. Thinking through it, I found really that there are two aspects that are here. Being authentic, on the one hand, being perceived as authentic, on the other hand. Ideally, as a brand, you are both. authentic and what people see as authentic. Some brands or some companies are authentic, nobody notices that. So you need more, let's say, a more Wonder Bra to be noticed. Just for seeing as authentic you aren't, then you have situations like this. But again, it's subjective. Which is the more innovative? The Japanese or Silicon Valley companies, based on these two pictures. Codes that you see in the Silicon Valley picture, the jeans, the cap, the high five, the event, those are sort of codes we associate with authentic innovation. So they think, they've got something going there, they're brilliant. The Japanese, on the other hand, it's one of their cultures to be uniform, which is a generalization, to be uniform at work, because it's their personality that counts. They differentiate themselves by who they are, by their ideas, not by what they look like. So what's more authentic? Another interesting aspect of authenticity is that it changes over time. This is Dieter Tedje, who is the CEO of Daimler. The bottom left is when he was the head of Daimler Chrysler, so not the top chef, but on his way there. Then he became head of Daimler in 2006, and I mean, that's him today. And you see that what was an authentic CEO about 20 years ago is a completely different picture to him today, the sneakers and jeans. The whole codes that you associate with the CEO have changed, also due to the whole start of the industry. It's as it knows, he needs to go with that. On one hand, he's setting a new standard for CEOs, what is acceptable, what we find authentic, and on the other hand, he knows it has to change, because otherwise, if you had like the old picture with that car, he's like having a negative effect on the image of the car. The two things don't fit together. So he has to be aware that he is also a touch point of the brand. Brands are all about perception. We've heard that several times today in various presentations. Basically, some of our experiences crossed over with our own prejudices and our culturalization and our subjective opinions. But it means that we have to be aware of perceptions in branding and create the perceptions that we want people to have in line with our group, in line with what we actually do, and not too far away. Here's a good example in Street in Graz, also in Vienna, and a few other towns of Eisenheister. This isn't design work by Moonly, I must add, but it is something that we admire, and it's very successful. And I've brought it along. It's an ice cream parlour. A great story. It's a milk farmer who couldn't get any money for his milk, and he turned to ice cream. It makes lovely sorts, natural ice cream without any additives, vegan, loads of lovely ingredients, fresh, that kind of thing. That's a good story. It's something we can really relate to. Yeah, it's a good cause. It's an underdog story of somebody becoming successful. If you look at this lovely ice cream parlor, it stands out. You really kind of want to go in there. But is it authentic? It's a romanticized view of what an ice cream parlor or a milk parlor looked like in the 50s, maybe, with a new twist, a bit of modernization, and a bit of today, and a bit of tomorrow in there. It's lovely and clean and fresh in the colors. And the girls behind the counter, they've got their little milkmaid costumes on. So there's a certain amount of staging here. It hasn't got much to do with real life, but still, it tells the story. It tells an authentic story, and it makes us feel good, particularly when we're queuing up to go in there. And this picture, I've seen this in real life in the street in Graz. There are two or three other ice salons on the same street where nobody's queuing. Not because the ice cream is any worse. The ice cream is also good in these other two ice cream bars. We want this kind of feeling. We want to be part of it. We want to be in this queue where all the other trendy, hopefully, people are going to be. We want to be part of that. Or not, again, subjective. But it brings us, as brand us, to an authenticity dilemma. The dilemma is, how much make-believe can you put into a brand before it then becomes a bit too fake? On the other hand, how much real life does it need? How much can you put in there? Have brands there who use real life? A couple of examples here. This picture is part of a campaign run by Desigual in Facebook, I think last week or the week before, where they use this model who the model herself says she's probably photoshopped. So you see sort of unphotoshopped legs. And think about this, yeah, again, real life is, yes, authentic, but is it really authentic? Is women's issues, feminist issues, for example, anything that Desigual has stood for up to now? Not so explicitly, as far as I know. It's also a bit Me Too, because Dove did something like that in 2006, and H&M never doing it. Instagram is full of pictures like this, so not that original either. So is it good for the brand? Is it authentic? In actual fact, you get the feeling that Desigual is jumping on this bandwagon. It's using an authentic picture to make a statement that doesn't really fit with what we thought they stood for. So being authentic doesn't mean putting real-life pictures into your brand. Another example that Lynn Hansberger came up with for me, which I find also very interesting, this is over-authentic. This is where they take an authentic and said, right, if they want authentic, we're going to really give them authentic here. This is a hotel in Amsterdam, or a hostel in Amsterdam. You can see the rooms there on the left-hand side. They've taken the worst thing and say, okay, this is back to basics. The website really over-authentic in that it's just information. No spin on it whatsoever. Here, this is the before and after picture when you stayed at the hotel. Before you're nice and fresh, at night there, you're absolutely trashed. Obviously, that's also not really authentic. It's a joke, it's making fun of authenticity more than anything else. It's quite interesting. I don't know if I want to say that, to be honest. Ideal authentic brand, and I sort of took heart in what Jakob was saying about, you know, think of people, think be an authentic person, and then out of that authentic person become a brand. And I thought of the nerds of this world, this is what this picture stands for, this sort of group, this community of people who are very unpretentious. They don't even care what so much what they look like, they have their glasses and everything, and they're there for physics or for code or whatever they do. I thought about what could a brand look like? Are there examples of brands that could look like this? If you translated nerds into a brand. This is my suggestion, again, subjective. Wikipedia. Down to basics. Pretty much no design. Lots of information, loads of text. Things you perhaps wouldn't associate normally with a brand. Free, absolutely free. The question is another brand? When I said, oh, is it actually before I had the sentence, this isn't another brand. Then Jakob said to me, yes, it is, I love Wikipedia. And then I realised that even this is very subjective, because just it's not fancy doesn't mean to say it can't be a brand. If you think, when all the brands go noisy and brandy and designy, maybe it's a very quiet brand like Wikipedia that then stands out more than the rest. It's worth thinking about. For me, it's not a particularly loved brand. It's a functional brand that informs me of stuff, but doesn't make me feel any better or worse about my brand. You feel differently. I thought I'd take some other examples where brands try to tell a bigger story. It's not always about authenticity, but they still want to stand out above the noise and be true to themselves and their groove, as you put it. These are just mainstream brands that you all know. It's about the principle behind it rather than the brand itself. Firstly, Lego. Authentic, people say it's all plastic. Oh my God, no, it's not. But as a brand, they try and stand for creativity, and everything they offer is a work around that, getting kids off the sofa to make stuff. This is their mission behind what they do. Yes, it's plastic. What their values stand for are creative playfulness, these kind of values. They try and bring their whole story have gone to a far more emotional level. Secondly, I've chosen Nike and this Find Your Greatness picture. Is it authentic? A lot of people say Nike, dodgy business practices, the quacks. Others would say, no, it's inclusive. It's getting people motivated to get up and do something. It's giving them energy. It's a moment where they say, oh yeah, good idea, I'm going to do it. I'm going to do it. Same thing for the just doing message altogether. So they're reaching for a higher, more emotional messaging than Nike does. Or in this case, Adidas is the third example, where they produce this line of shoes out of plastic that has been reclaimed from the oceans. So you could say, well, they're jumping on the bandwagon of a problem they created. It's one point of view. Or you could say, no, they're helping me have an impact on that problem. See, otherwise I haven't a chance to help the oceans. We live in Austria, a landlocked country, but with this shoe, I can do something about that. Now, I've chosen these examples on purpose because I want to codify them to help you clarify your thoughts about that as well. Take a look at this. This is the value pyramid, based on the value pyramid from Bain & Company. Look it up. It's a good source of information around us here and for structuring what your brand stands for. At the bottom, well, basically what the pyramid said is that there are different levels of value that you can offer your company. Your customer. There'll be functional value at the bottom, and if you move up the pyramid, your customers will find more meaning in what you do, will be more loyal. Now, if we add the brands I mentioned before to this pyramid, you can see, and this is my subjective opinion, this codification, you'd have a different order of brands. For me, Wikipedia is a functional brand, it informs me, but it doesn't touch me otherwise. Lego, emotional because it's about creativity, it's about having a sense of achievement when you build Kylo Ren's space shuttle, it's a complex like that, you can do a lot. So it's an emotional thing. The Nike example is helping motivating me to change my life, it's motivating me to reach life goals, so it's talking to me on a higher level of value. And Adidas is helping me have social impact, as mentioned before. That's the highest level, it can help people. Help having a social impact in whatever area, that's a good thing. As I said, this is my you said that, rightly so, Wikipedia. Also, being free of charge, offering free knowledge to the world is also something that has social impact. Completely right. If that's your mindset. The thing is here to know, who am I aiming my brand at? Who's the community that will find this meaning, One word of warning though, the higher you go up the value chain, the more you use ethical issues in your branding, the more you have to deliver. And the harsher you will be punished if you show people that you don't really mean it. So if you say you're interested in getting plastic out of the ocean and that issue, you have to carry it through. You can't be then found dumping plastic bags in the sea because that's the end of your brand authenticity. Authenticity, my finding, is a moving target, unfortunately. That's no straight answer for you. It's subjective. It's changing as times change, as fashions change. It's influenced by branding. Branding influences our perceptions. So it can be used more silent. And it punishes broken promises. What you can do for more authenticity in your brand, focus your brand idea or your groove around who your customers want to become. Concentrate on that question, a vision of what your customers want to become. Go all out to help your customers reach that vision of what you do, how you do it, where you do it. It's not about positioning your products anymore, it's about positioning your customers to what they do. Secondly, aim higher up the value pyramid. If you want it really to matter to people, you want to offer them meaning. Be careful not to make your promises. And thirdly, use design and storytelling as a kind of wonder bra, like a shortcut into people's hearts, a little lift, Like when you flirt with your new partner, you see your best side. So that your brand becomes a little story for the rest of us, but an authentic one. Thank you very much.